Kicking off Juneteenth, cities in Northeast Arkansas are beginning to celebrate Juneteenth. The holiday commemorates the emancipation of African-American slaves in the U.S. Blytheville began its celebrations today. Alejandra Hernandez was there and has the story.
Without African-American history, there's no history.
A history that is over 100 years in the making. Juneteenth, the day that commemorates the emancipation of African-American slaves in the United States. In Blytheville, the celebrations kicked off at the Ritz Theater with a play written by Geneva Aldrich Harris.
We're just highlighting African-American accomplishments from slavery and beyond, all the way up to 2023.
Play honored different eras of African American history, starting with slavery.
Just please imagine being sold into slavery for years of cruelty by a man you called master.
And this taking us all the way back to how we came up, how the slavery came up and stuff, and what they did back in slavery, chopped cotton and did all that. And coming back to it is just bringing up today, the generation of today.
As well as more recent history, like the Tuskegee Airmen, African-American pilots who fought in World War II. Music is just as important as the words used in her plays. For many, like James Sanders, the play taught an invaluable lesson.
This is not an adult thing. This is something that even they can be involved with, and their accomplishments can be put up on screen as well.
The city of Blytheville has celebrated Juneteenth for nearly 10 years, even before Juneteenth became a federal holiday. But for the city, it just wasn't enough to celebrate the event in one day.
It would bring unity to Blytheville, bring awareness to all of the races of Blytheville, and to educate our youth, because they need to know about the past in order to appreciate what's going on now in the future.
In Blytheville, Alejandra Hernandez, KATE News.
Can you feel it? Can you feel it? Can you feel it?
This is our jump off. Pastor Jones here to offer prayer. Let's take in this message. Let's make sure we leave this place with a lesson, and let's learn and let's love. Thank you.
Those who know how to worship, to somebody. We got a church in here today. Somebody for the help of the program. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I know the devil don't like it.
Hallelujah.
But we say hallelujah, Jesus. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we have gathered here today to enjoy the honoring of the Tuskegee Airmen. We come today knowing that you are still God. We realize today that this is not a designated house of worship, but it is a house full of worshipers right now. And we must do what worshipers do in the name of Jesus. We pray for the success of this great showing. We pray for the success of those who put it together. Bless all of them, Lord God, that we might be lights in this dark world. Now bless us today to get an understanding and to liken it unto a spiritual expedition. We know, Lord God, that you are real among everything, above everything. You are real. Now we say thank you, Jesus, for all things. Give us the peace and safety in this house today. Lord God, guard and guide us. That's in the name of Jesus. We say glory.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Imagine being a king or a queen in your own country and being stripped of your royalty. Imagine being captured, put on a ship, bound in chains, and shackled in the hollow of its belly for month after month. Can you imagine being taken off the ship in a foreign country where you see strange looking and talking people parading you in the square and strip searching you? Just please imagine being sold into slavery for years of cruelty by a man you called master. Now, imagine the unimaginable, being held in slavery for 2.5 years after slaves were freed. I hope you can imagine. Imagine. Imagine.
Already made, so young and not so strong. They're just waiting to be saved. Oh. Yeah.
That was only so the slave owners wouldn't hear their cries. It's been said that I led at least 70 people to freedom, including my elderly mother and father. I never ran my train off track, and I never lost a passenger. I am Harriet Tubman.
Where are you going? Come back here! Come back here, I say! Come back here!
I'm gonna be free. I die. With my face turned to the sun, weight on my shoulder, a bullet in my gun. See, I got eyes in the back of my head, just in case I have to run. For my people, while the clouds roll back in the stars feel the night, that's when I'm gonna stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home, far across the river. Can you hear freedom calling? Keeping on, I'm going to stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home, far across the river. Can you hear freedom calling, calling me to answer? Keep on keeping on, I can feel it in my bones. 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 Harry Tubman.
Hear ye, hear ye, hear ye. I'm representing William H. Seward, Secretary of State for the United States of America. I'm commissioned to read these excerpts from the Constitution of the United States of America concerning slavery. Whereas on the 22nd day of September, in the year of our Lord, 1862, a proclamation was issued by the President of the United States containing, among other things, the following, to wit, that on the first day of January in the year of our Lord, 1863, all persons held as slaves within any state or designated part of a state, the people whereof shall then be in rebellion against the United States, shall be then, thenceforward and forever, free. And the executive government of the United States, including the military and naval authority thereof, will recognize and maintain the freedom of such persons, and will do no act or acts to repress such persons or any of them in any efforts they may make for their actual freedom. Now, therefore, I, Abraham Lincoln, President of the United States, by the power in me vested as Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy of the United States in time of actual armed rebellion against the authority and government of the United States, and as a fit and necessary war measure for suppressing such said rebellion, do on this first day of January in the year of our Lord 1863, and in accordance with my purpose, so to do so publicly proclaim for the full period of 100 days from the day above mentioned, and designate as the state and part of states wherein the people thereof respectively are free. And by virtue and for the purpose aforesaid, I do order and declare that all persons held as slaves within such designated states and parts of states are and henceforward shall be free, and that the executive government of the United States, including the military and naval authorities thereof, will recognize and maintain the freedom of said persons. And I do enjoin upon the people so declared to be free to abstain from all violence unless in necessary self-defense. And I recommend to them that in all cases, when allowed, they labor faithfully for reasonable wages. And I declare and make known that such persons of suitable condition shall be received into the armed service of the United States, the garrison forts, positions, stations, and other places, and to man vessels of all sorts in said service. This is the Emancipation Declaration. President Lincoln used this as part of his party platform for the upcoming 1864 presidential election. His efforts met with success when the House passed the 13th Amendment in January 1865 with a vote of 119-56. On February the 1st, President Abraham Lincoln approved the joint resolution of Congress submitting the proposed amendment to the state legislatures. The 13th Amendment was ratified by 3/4 of the states on December the 6th, 1865.
Oh, it ain't fair, massa. It ain't fair, massa. Won't you let us go home? Well, I said, it ain't fair, massa. It ain't fair, massa. Well, it ain't fair, massa. Won't you let us go home? Oh, I am tired, so sick and tired. It ain't fair now, so won't you let us go home?
I am representing Union General Gordon Ganger. I have traveled here to Galveston, Texas to announce General Order 3 on this 19th day of June in the year of 1863, and the order states, the people are informed that in accordance with the proclamation from the execution of the United States, all slaves are free. This involves an absolutely equally and personal rights and rights of property. between former masters and slaves, and the connection heretofore existing between them become the between employers and hired labor. The free are advised to remain at their present home and work for wages. They're informed that they were not allowed to collect at any military post, and that they will not be supported in idleness, neither there or elsewhere. They are free.
It sure is hot out here, but I don't mind because I'm free. Like, loose them shackles and dance.
I understand that I should praise you through my everything that could go wrong always wrong at one time. So much pressure fell on me, I thought I was gonna lose my mind. Don't I know you wanna see if I will hold on through these trials? But I need you to lift this load, cause I can't take it no more. I just want to be so lucky,
Section 1, neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment of a crime whereof the duly party shall have been convicted, shall not exist within the United States of America or any other place of their jurisdiction. Section 2, Congress should have the power to pursue these articles with appropriate legislation.
Thank you. to do is hurt me.
Ain't I a woman? I'm only 13 no water. Where your Christ come from?
No.
Where yours came from? God in a woman. Man
on.
Had nothing to do with it.
Civil Rights Movement, best known for her pivotal role in the Montgomery Bus boycott. Her refusal to surrender her seat to a white man, passenger on a Montgomery, Alabama bus on December 1st, 1955, triggered a wave of protest that reverberated throughout the United States. Her quiet, courageous act changed America, its view of black people, and redirected the course of history. After the arrest of Rosa Parks, black people of Montgomery and sympathizers of other races organized and promoted a boycott of the city bus line that lasted 381 days. Wow. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was appointed the spokesperson for the bus boycott and taught nonviolence to all participants. In September 1996, President William Jefferson Clinton, the 42nd President of the United States of America, gave Mrs. Parks the Medal of Freedom, the highest award given to a civilian citizen, a quiet exemplification of courage, dignity, and determination. Rosa Parks was a symbol to all to remain free. Published Act No. 28 of 1997 designated the first Monday following February the 4th as Mrs. Parks' Rosa Parks Day in the state of Michigan, her home state. She was the first living person to be honored with a holiday. As a role model for youth, she was stimulated by their enthusiasm to learn as much about her life as possible. A modest person, she always encouraged them to research the lives of others contributors to World Peace. Mrs. Rosa Parks.
Going home to my Lord.
Michelle Obama. Michelle Obama was the first African-American First Lady of the United States of America. Since the former First Lady stepped into the spotlight over 15 years ago, she has been speaking inspiring words from her main news about hope, friendship, and loving kindness with anyone that could use a boost. Michelle served as a role model for women and worked as an advocate for poverty awareness, education, nutrition, physical activity, and healthy eating. She supported American designers and was considered a fashion icon herself. After her husband's presidency, Obama's influence has remained high. When she spoke of hardships, she said, "I'm coming down from the mountaintop to tell every young person that is poor and working class and have been told, regardless of the color of your skin, that you don't belong. Don't listen to them. They don't even know how they got to where they are." Becoming First Lady wasn't about arriving someplace or achieving a certain aim. It instead was a forward motion and a means of evolving, a way to reach continuously toward a better self. If it's, excuse me, the journey doesn't end, no country can even truly flourish if it stifles the potential of its women and deprives itself of the contributions of half its citizens. Barack and Michelle, both raised by families who didn't have much in the way of money or material possessions, but had given them something far more valuable: their unconditional love, their unflinching sacrifice, and a chance to go places they never imagined for themselves. When she heard about negative and false attacks, she really didn't invest any energy into them because she knew who she was. When someone walks up to you, don't look around. Don't look beyond them. Look them in the eye and take in their story. She wanted our young people to know that they matter and that they belong. She urged them not to be afraid. Be focused, be determined, be hopeful, be empowered. Empower yourselves with a good education. Then get out there and use that education to build a country worthy of your boundless promises. Lead by example with hope and never fear. You cannot take your freedoms for granted like generations who've come before us. You have to do your part to preserve and protect these freedoms. You need to be preparing yourselves to add a voice to our national conversations. Are you good enough? Yes, you are. Strong men who are role models don't have to down women to make themselves feel powerful. One thing I've learned in life is the power of using your voice. Instead of letting your hardships and your failures discourage or exhaust you, let them inspire you. Let them make you hungrier to succeed. Choose people to lift you up. Find people who make you better. You have to fill your bucket with positive energy. And if you have people hanging around you that are bringing you down and not lifting you up, whether it's your boo, your best friend, you have to learn to push those people aside. Michelle Obama.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Lily Jackson, and I concur with Ms. Michelle Obama because on January 2021, Kamala D. Harris became the first woman, the first African-American woman, the first Indian-American, the first person of Asian American descent, the first graduate
of an historical black college and university to be sworn the Vice President of the United States of America. I am on the floor. All right, on the floor. That's something all of you are shouting about, right? As she said in her election speech, she may be the first, but she will not be the last. Kamala Harris has spent a lifetime breaking glass ceilings, and she did that, and she has continued to break those ceilings. Harris is the daughter of immigrants. Her father was born in Jamaica. Her mother is born in India. They divorced. Her mother took them to India and spent time there, but she also made it important for them to be part of their African-American culture. She made sure that they was aware of who they were, because when they came back to the United States, she had to make sure that they were indwelled in their culture, because eventually she was raising children that they had to understand that they were black children, that they had to understand the black culture, that they had to understand that even though people saw them as being immigrants, that they were still black. And within saying that, she knew that they had to adopt to the homeland, which they will be growing up as, determined to make sure that they will grow into confident, proud, black women. Thank you. You have heard about her today, Harriet Tubman, American abolitionist and social activist. She escaped away to freedom, but she was not content to seek freedom for herself alone. Tubman, a Moses of our people, made some 13 missions to rescue at least 70 enslaved people, including friends and family. Harriet Tubman was the first woman to lead a major military operation in the United States. She and some 150 African American soldiers rescued more than 700 slaves during a raid during the Civil War. Like this historic and heroic black woman, I too serve as a Moses in my time. All right. I am the daughter of two parents who themselves were like long educators. They instilled in my five brothers and myself the importance of education, hard work, faith in God, and love for family and community. I am a veteran, having served the Arkansas Army National Guard in the 39th Support and Transportation Unit in Stuttgart, Arkansas. I am a proud alumni of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. I am a proud member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated. I hold a doctorate in educational leadership, and I have served education for the past 29 years. And my accomplishment now is that I am the first African American woman to formally serve as the superintendent of schools for the Bible School District. I am Dr. Veronica Roberts Hawkins, and I continue the legacy of great American African American Moses as I seek to fulfill my mission to lead the Bible School District to academic freedom. Good afternoon, Bible. Good afternoon, Bible. Somebody say with me, it's time.
It's time.
Past time. Somebody say it's time.
It's time.
Now time. Somebody say it's time.
It's time.
It's time to get it done.
Yeah.
Shirley Chisholm said, and I quote, "You don't make progress by standing on the sidelines, by whimpering, and by complaining. You make progress by implementing change, by coming up with great ideas." And she was the first black woman elected to U.S. Congress. She was the first woman and black person to make a bid for the presidential office, and my name is Melissa Rochelle Whaley Logan. And I am the first female and the second black person to be elected to office of mayor in the beautiful city of Miami. And today, I stand here before this beautiful crowd to give homage to where I come from. I am a product of Blytheville, Arkansas, the place that they call Thug Town, the place that they say will never be anything. But let me tell you, can something good come out of Blytheville? My answer to that is yes, it can, and yes, it will. I give homage to my parents, Drs. Reverend Laddie and Dr. Pauline Whaley. I too am an educated black woman. I have a bachelor's degree in business administration. I have a bachelor's degree in behavioral science. I have a master's degree in law, and I will graduate this December with my PhD in public administration. So I stand here confident, knowing that I'm not standing on the sideline. The people have put me in the game, and guess what? It's game time.
Attention! I am here as a representative for the Tuskegee Airmen. I am proud to tell the historic story about the origin of the 99th Pursuit Squadron Civil Rights Legacy. First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt visit marked the initiation of the Army's African American pilot program and the activation of the first all African American military aviation unit, the 99th Pursuit Squadron, later known as Freedom Fighter Squadron. It became the first black squadron to fight in World War II. The Tuskegee Airmen were a group of African-American military fighters and bomber pilots. The approximately 1,000 strong group were the first African-American soldiers to successfully complete their training and enter the Army Air Corps. The Tuskegee Airmen were best known for proving during World War II that black men could be elite fighter pilots. The Tuskegee Airmen was able to impact segregation by non-violent direct action. Their action, Tuskegee Airmen's most influential moment came collectively during the civil disobedience in the spring of 1945. And what became as the Freedom Field Mutiny. After enduring years of inadequate training facilities, discriminatory policies, hostile commanders in the Army Air Force, 101 officers of the all-black 477th Bombardment Group, who had initially trained in Tuskegee at Tuskegee Airfield in Alabama, were arrested in Indiana Freedmen's Field Base, where they refused to sign a base regulation requiring separate officers' club for black and white soldiers. The order came after 65 black officers were arrested trying to enter the white officers' club. These men were not alone. They were not alone. The War Department had in 1944 issued an order that all recreational facilities will be segregated, will be integrated. This action proved the support that the officers needed. The White Officers Club had amenities fit for a king, The Black Officers Club had amenities fit for a slave. The Black officers nicknamed their club Uncle Tom's Cabin and refused to patronize it. Military officials, to be attributed to their decision to the belief that fraternization between instructors and trainees would have an ill effect on the group's training. In truth, the effort was a transparent attempt to circumvent both the letter and the law, which prohibits segregation on basis based on race. On April the 5th, 1945, Black officers attempted two times to integrate the White Officers Club at Freedman's Field. 100 of the 104 Black officers were arrested, and they faced charges, and they were flown to Kentucky. Of that 100, there was a Bill Terry, the third officer. Bill Terry was fined. And he was charged with disobeying an officer and found guilty of jostling. He was given a $150 fine. He received a dishonorable discharge and a reduction in rank. But General Hunter wanted all of the men court-martialed, but the judge, Advocate General Office, demand that reprimand be adequate punishment because he did not want to see this as a black eye with political effort against the military. On April the 25th, 1945, 12 days after their arrest, the 105 Black officers who were released, amen, with a reprimand on their record after pressure from the NAACP, National Urban League, and the Black Press. Following the airman's release, a columnist wrote, "It is impossible for any man to be a first-class officer if constantly forced into second-class position." Right. It is a pleasure to note that the War Department had the good sense to release these young men back to duty. Tuskegee Airmen believed their defiance broke the camel's back, because the military had to recognize the fact that 104 Black officers were arrested and that they all defied this order, and the order was said to be illegal. Terry said in an interview, "We feel that, and I think I speak for most of the guys, that it was our advantage that we give to the Negro people that there would be no discrimination in the Army's military Air Force from this time on officially." 1948, Harriet Truman issued Executive Order 9981, ordering all military facilities to desegregate. In 1995, President Bill Clinton pardoned Terry, restored his rank to second lieutenant, refunded his $150, and removed all reprimand letters from his permanent file. And also 15 of the other 104 officers charged in the protest, and he promised to remove the remaining reprimand of the other 89 officers once they were filed. Please stand with me as we applaud the Tuskegee Airmen for their fight in the war and against racial discrimination.
Take my hand.
Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is known for being an iconic figure in the advancement of civil rights in the United States of America and around the world. He is often presented as a heroic leader in the history of modern American liberalism. Drawing inspiration from both his Christian faith and peaceful teaching of Mahatma Gandhi, Dr. King led a nonviolent movement in the late 1950s and 60s to achieve legal equality for African Americans in the United States. While others were advocating for freedom by any means necessary, including violence, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. used the power of words and acts of nonviolent resistance, such as protests, grassroots organizing, and civil disobedience to achieve seemingly impossible goals. He went on to lead similar campaigns against poverty and international conflicts, always maintaining fidelity to his principles that men and women everywhere, regardless of color or creed, are equal members of the human family. Following Rosa Parks' arrest in 1955 for refusing to move to the back of the bus in Montgomery, Alabama, he organized a year-long bus boycott, the Montgomery Movement. This led to integration of the city's buses and launched a nonviolent protest movement that spread across the United States. King was arrested 30 times for his participation in civil rights activities. In 1963, he was one of the organizers for the March on Washington. And the following year, he received the Nobel Peace Prize. In 1965, Dr. King helped to organize the Selma to Montgomery marches. He worked tirelessly. For the less than 13 years of Dr. King's leadership of the modern American civil rights movement, from December 1955 until April 4, 1968, African Americans achieved more genuine progress towards racial equality in America than the previous 350 years had produced. Dr. King is widely regarded as America's preeminent advocate of nonviolence and one of the greatest nonviolent leaders in world history. He assured the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and was in attendance when President Johnson signed both the Act and the Voting Rights Act of 1965 into law. In the final years of his life, he expanded his focus to include poverty and the Vietnam War. Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech, Nobel Peace Prize lecture, and letter from a Birmingham jail are among the most revered oration writings in the English language. His accomplishments are now taught to American children of all races, and his teachings are studied by scholars and students worldwide. He is the only non-president to have a national holiday dedicated in his honor, and is the only non-president memorialized on the Great Wall in the nation's capital. He is memorialized in hundreds of statues, parks, streets, squares, churches, and other public facilities around the world as a leader whose teachings are increasingly relevant to the progress of mankind. Dr. King was assassinated on April 4, 1968 in Memphis, Tennessee, on the balcony of the Lorraine Motel. He was there to help striking sanitation workers. In 1963, President Ronald Reagan approved a bill to establish a federal holiday in the honor of the civil rights leader. King said, "Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Let's love one another." I can hear his voice ringing out today. He is saying to us, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last." Amen.
President Barack.
Former President Barack Obama served as the 44th President of the United States of America.
All right.
His story is the American story. With values from the heartland, a middle class upbringing and a strong family, hard work and education as the means of getting ahead, and the conviction that a life so blessed should be lived to serve others. Barack was elected as president in 2008. He became the first African American to hold the office. The framers of the Constitution always hoped that our leadership would not be limited to Americans of wealth or family connection. Subject to the prejudice of their time, many of them owned slaves and would have not have foreseen an African American president, Obama said. We the people recognize that we have responsibilities as well as rights, that our destiny are bound together, and that a freedom which only asks, what's in it for me? A freedom without a commitment to others, a freedom without love or charity or duty or patriotism is unworthy of our founding ideals and those who died in their defense. If the people cannot trust their government to do the job for which it exists, to protect them and to promote their common welfare, all else is lost. There is not a liberal America or a conservative America. There is the United States of America. There is not a black America and a white America and a Latina America and an Asian America. There is the United States of America. It took a lot of blood, sweat, and tears to get to where we are today, but we had just begun. Today we begin in earnest the work of making sure that the world we leave our children is better than the one we inhabit.
Come on.
Let's focus on the ideal. Everybody should have an equal opportunity to succeed, no matter whom you are, what you look like, or where you come from, you can make it. That's an essential promise of America. Where you start should not determine where you end up. It's not enough to train today's workforce. We also need to prepare tomorrow's workforce by guaranteeing every child a world-class education. We need to steer clear of this poverty of ambition, where people want to drive fancy cars, wear nice clothes, live in nice apartments, but don't want to work hard to achieve those things. Everybody should try to realize their full potential. We need to reject any politics that target people because of their race or religion. This is a matter of political correctness. It's a matter of understanding what makes us strong. The world respects us not just for our arsenal. It respects us for our diversity and our openness, and the way that we respect each other's faith. If you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change.
Amen.
If you don't like something, change it.
Amen.
If you can't change it, change your attitude.
Amen.
To improve is to change. To be perfect is to change often. Progress is impossible without change. And those who cannot change their minds cannot change anything. The only way to make sense out of change is to plunge into it, move with it, join the dance. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. You must be the change you wish to see in the world. Change is the law of life. And those who only look to the past or present are sure to miss the future. There is nothing permanent except change. If you do not change direction, you may end up where you're heading. When we are no longer able to change the situation we're in, we are challenged to change ourselves. The first step towards change is awareness. The second step is acceptance. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Change. Yes, we can. Si se puede. Yes, we have, and yes, we will.
Civil rights movement ever produced. John Lewis has dedicated his life to protect human rights, secure personal dignity, and build what he calls the love community. He displays a sense of ethnic immorality that has won him the admiration of many of his colleagues in the United States Congress. John Lewis was born the son of a sharecropper outside the city of Troy, Alabama. He grew up in his family's farm and attended segregated public schools. At an early age, John Lewis developed an unwavering commitment to the civil rights movement. For more than 40 years, he was the vanguard of progressive social movement and the human rights struggle in the United States. He organized sit-in demonstrations at segregated lunch counters and volunteered to participate in the Freedom Ride, which was organized to challenge segregation in state bus terminals across the South during the height of the Civil Rights Movement. Lewis was the chairman of the Student Nonviolent Coalition Committee. Despite his youth, John Lewis became a recognized leader in the Civil Rights Movement. He was one of the Big Six. Lewis, at age 23, was one of the planners and keynote speakers in the historical march on Washington. During the Mississippi Freedom Summit, he organized voting registration drives and community active programs. He led over 600 marches across the Edwin Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama. State troopers attacked the march in confrontations that became known as Bloody Sunday. Despite more than 40 years, physical attacks and serious injuries, he remained a devoted advocate of nonviolence. Elected to Congress in 1986, Lewis represented Georgia's 5th Congressional District. John Lewis coined the phrase of getting into good trouble. He is gone, but his work will live on for generations to come.
Thank you.
Representative Hakeem Jeffries has picked up the torch in Washington, D.C. as the first African-American to serve as Democratic leader of the House of Representatives. The 118th Congress is also famous for another first. History will record it as being led by a majority leader that took 15 ballot elections to elect. Yep. 1 minute. God help us all. Jeffries hadn't been elected to that position by his colleagues in November of 2022, and in the capacity is the highest ranking Democrat in the House of Representatives. As Democrats, he assured us on his watch that they will never compromise our values. They will put forth the ABCs of the Democratic Party to work for the people, he promised. We will put American values over autocracy, benevolence over bigotry, the Constitution over the cult, democracy over demagogues, economic opportunity over extremism, freedom over fascism, government over gaslighting, hopefulness over hatred, inclusion over isolation, justice over judicial overreach, knowledge over kangaroo court, liberty over limitations, maturity over Mar-a-Lago. If you didn't hear me, maturity over Mar-a-Lago. Normalcy over negativity. Opportunity over instruction. People over politics. Quality of life over QAnon. Reason over racism. Substance over slander. Triumph over tyranny. Understanding over ugliness. Voter rights over voter suppression. Working families over well-connected. Xenia over xenophobia. Yes, we can over you can't do it. And zealous representation over a zero-sum confrontation. We will always do the right things for the American people. So let us not grow weary over well-doing, for the American people will reap the harvest if we don't give up. God bless you. God bless the House of Representatives. God bless the United States of America.
Juneteenth flag. You might see another red, white, blue flag flying today over state capitals and city buildings. That banner with a bursting star in the middle is the Juneteenth flag, a symbolic representation of the end of slavery in the United States. The flag is a brainchild of activist Ben Half, founder of National Juneteenth Celebration Foundation. Half created the flag in 1997 with the help of co-laborers and Boston-based illustrator Lisa Jean Graff. They brought their vision to life, and we are the recipients of their labor. The flag was revised in 2000 into the version we know today, according to National Juneteenth Observation Foundation. 7 years later, the date June 19, 1865 was added, commemorating the date that Union Army Major General Gordon Granger rode into Galveston, Texas, and told enslaved African Americans of their emancipation. For two decades now, communities around the country have held flag-raising ceremonies on Juneteenth in celebration of their freedom. The Juneteenth flag is full of symbols, and we would like for you to know what they mean. The flag, first and foremost, commemorates the day that slavery ended in the United States. Secondly, it represents Texas, the Lone Star State, because it was in Galveston in 1865 where Union soldiers informed that country's last remaining enslaved people that they were free. First and foremost, we would like to show you the elements of the flag and what they represent. The star in the center has a dual meaning. For one, it represents Texas, the Lone Star State, but it also goes beyond Texas, representing the freedom of African Americans in all 50 states. The first thing outlined around the star is inspired by the novel and the term that the astronomers used to mean a new star. On the Juneteenth flag, that represents a new beginning for African Americans of Galveston and throughout the land. Last, the arch. The curve that extends across the width of the flag represents a new horizon, the opportunities, and the promise that lay ahead for Black Americans.
The red, white, and blue represent the American flag, a reminder that slaves and their descendants were and are Americans.
The curve that extends across the width of the flag represents a new horizon, the opportunity and promise they lay ahead for Black Americans.
Astronomers used to mean a new star. The Juneteenth represent a new beginning for the African Americans of Galveston throughout the land.
The date, June 19, 1865, represents the day that the slave Black people in Galveston, Texas became Americans under the law. And while African Americans today are still fighting for equality and justice, the color symbolizes the continuous commitment of the people of the United States to do better and to live to the idea of liberty and justice for all.
Close this celebration of Juneteenth. We must vow to keep our pursuit for freedom moving forward. Freedom is what Juneteenth is about. Let us be forever mindful that freedom is the power to act, speak, or think as one wants without hindrance or restraint. Freedom, however, comes from the same root as friend and Indo-European word that means dear or beloved. It makes a connection to other free people by bonds of kinship or affection, unlike a slave. Our ancestors have been champions of American freedom, but yet, in 2023, we still do not have total freedom. Freedom should be absent of subjection to race or an autocratic government system. There are three types of freedom. The first kind of freedom is freedom from. A freedom from the constraints of society. Second, freedom to. A freedom to do what we want to do. And thirdly, freedom to be. A freedom not just to do what we want to do, but a freedom to be who we were meant to be.
All right.
Real freedom in America should be the unconditional right of being able or allowed to do, say, and think whatever you want to without being controlled or limited. Our five freedoms in America are speech, religion, press, assembly, and the right to petition the government. Together, these five guaranteed freedoms make the people of the United States of America the most freest people in the world. In an edition known as the Four Freedom Speech, the speaker proposed four fundamental freedoms that people everywhere in the world ought to enjoy. Freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. In America today, having the right to participate in politics and elections, expressions of unpopular ideas without fearing for one's safety, is being threatened at our highest level of government. Amen. I look forward to the day in America when all of its peoples can be in a state of not being captive or enslaved by our fellow citizens as we continue to thrust our way to freedom. We support the absence of necessity, coerce, or constraint in our choices and actions. We deserve liberation from slavery and from the power of another human being. Independence is the quality or state that every man and woman should be afforded. Freedom is what this country was founded on and prides itself in. I sum up freedom as the power or condition of acting without compulsion. Freedom has a broad range of applications from total absence of restraint to merely a sense of not being unduly hampered or frustrated. However, my brothers and sisters, freedom comes with responsibility. We, as American citizens, should voluntarily use our ability to act or not act out of free will and self-determination. Perception, intuition, and will. Liberty is the golden word of freedom. When liberty totally begins to take root, it will be a rapid growth. Life without liberty is like a body without a soul. Liberty in the open window through which pours the sunlight of the human spirit and human dignity. I challenge each of you to recognize individuality, anticipate flexibility, understand circumstances, build relationships, set priorities, build on prior learning, be task-driven, give quality feedback, take a risk, be motivated, become aware, and develop a unique pathway, and one day, we will willingly and be truly free at last. As caveat, take these words home with you from Rudolph Hiller, inspirational poem If by Ellen Thompson.
If you can keep your head when it's all about you and losing theirs and blaming it on you. If you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make an allowance of them doubting you too. If you can wait and not get tired by waiting, or being lied about and don't deal in lies, or being hate and don't give away to hating, yet not look too good or too wise. If you can dream and make dreams your master, if you can think and make thoughts your aim, if you can meet with the triumph and disasters and treat those two impostors the same. If you can bear to hear the truth you're spoken, twisted by craze to make traps for fools, or watch the things you gave your life to broken and stoop and build them up with worn out tools. If you can make one leap of your winnings and risk it all in a turn of piss and toss, and lose and start again at the beginning and never breathe a word about your loss. If you can force your heart and nerve and soul to serve your turn alone after they're gone, and so on, hold on when there is nothing in you except for the will which say to them, hold on. If you can talk with the crowd and keep your virtue, or walk with the king and lose common touch, if either false or no loving friends can hurt you, if all men count with you, but none too much. If you can feel the unforgivable minute with second seconds worth of distant run, yours is the earth and everything is in it, and which is more, you will be a man, my son.
Thank you. celebrations from Kansas City for a successful production. We want to celebrate who you are to your community each and every day. You are a shining example of how to achieve anything through dedication and perseverance. We are proud of you. Congratulations from the Long family.